After the death of Abimelech, Tola rises to save Israel, and he judges for 23 years. Then Jair judges Israel for 22 years, and he has 30 sons who ride on 30 donkeys, and they have 30 cities in the land of Gilead. After the death of Jair, Israel returns to Baal worship, and the Lord allows the Philistines to dominate them. For 18 years, they influenced the Israelites in Gilead and the tribes of Judah, Benjamin, and Ephraim. Not all of Israel is under Philistine control, yet they are all disturbed by their cousins who are. They cry again to the Lord, reporting and begging for deliverance and for a deliverer. The Lord will not deliver them until they put away Baal and worship him only. When they do, the Lord is ready to help with Jephthah. The Amorites are camped at Gilead, and the Israelites are at Mizpah. And for 18 years they have struggled, and now they look for a leader. And Jephthah is a mighty warrior. His father is Gilead, but his mother is a harlot. And when Gilead's other sons grow up, they drive Jephthah away, denying him his inheritance. So he lives in Job with several worthless men. When the Ammonites cause trouble for the city of Gilead, they send elders to get Jephthah's help. He questions them why they have come to him after chasing him off, and they assure him that they need him to be their head. So Jephthah goes with them back to Mizpah. Jephthah sends a message to the Ammonites recounting the actions of Moses with them and the Moabites when he was trying to lead Israel to the east side of the Jordan. The Lord drove them out of the land so Israel could possess it. So if Ammon's God will give them land, they can possess it. The kings of Ammon just disregarded his message. So the Spirit of the Lord helps Jephthah move his army up to the cities of Ammon. And Jephthah makes a vow to the Lord that if he defeats Ammon, he will sacrifice whatever comes out of the door of his house as a burnt offering. Well, Jephthah defeats the Ammonites in their cities, more than 20 cities as a fact. And coming home, his daughter meets him with tambourines and dance. And he is devastated as he tells his daughter of his vow. She is supportive of his vow, telling him to do as he promised the Lord. However, since she is a virgin, she asks him to let her go to the mountain with her friends to mourn. And for 2 months, she is on the mountain, and when she returns, Jephthah kills her, fulfilling his promise. Therefore, every year, the daughters of Israel commemorate her death for 4 days. Some of the tribes of Ephraim hear of Jephthah's battle with the Amorites, and they are furious because he did not call them for help. Jephthah tells them that he did not call them because they had not helped him in the past when he called for their aid. Ephraim attacks, but Jephthah conquers them. After that, when an Ephraimite tries to cross to Gilead, the Gileadites will ask him if he's from Ephraim. If he says no, they will ask him to say Shibboleth. If he pronounces it correctly, they will let him by. If he mispronounces it, they will kill him at the Jordan. Jephthah kills 42,000 Ephraimites and rules for 6 years. After Jephthah, Ibzan judges Israel for 7 years. Little is known about him except that he had 30 sons and 30 daughters, and all 60 of his children married non-Israelites. His home is Bethlehem, and that is where he's buried. Elon follows Ibzan and judges Israel for 10 years. He's from the tribe of Zebulun, and he's buried in that area. Abdon is the son of Hillel, and he has 70 sons and 30 grandsons who ride on 70 donkeys. And he judges for 8 years, and when he dies, they bury him there in the land of Ephraim. And after the death of Abdon, Israel returns to her evil ways, worshiping other gods. So the Lord allows the Philistines to dominate them for 40 years. Now Manoah and his wife have no children. But one day the angel of the Lord approaches her and says she will give birth to a son. And he tells her not to drink wine or anything from the vine because the boy is to be a Nazarite. She runs to tell Manoah and they plead for the angel to return. The angel returns to the woman while she is in the field, and she runs to bring Manoah, and he asks the angel for instructions on how to raise the child. The angel repeats that the woman is not to drink anything from the vine or eat anything that's unclean. And when the boy is born, no razor is to touch his head because he will be a Nazarite to the day of his death. Manoah asks the angel to stay and to eat a goat that he will prepare, and the angel refuses, asking him to offer it as a burnt offering to the Lord instead. So Manoah makes the offering, and the angel does wonderful miracles during the ceremony. Then the angel departs by ascending to heaven in a flame of fire, and Manoah knows then that he has been with the angel of the Lord. And when the boy is born, they name him Samson, and they raise him as a Nazarite. So Samson is born, and he is quite an amazing child with strength beyond measure. As Samson grows up, all the people are amazed at his strength. They will tie him with ropes, and he will break them with ease. He'll wrestle lions by himself, barehanded. Not a single man can overpower Samson. Nothing can stop him for these 20 years. Even though the Philistines are coming at him, nothing can stop him. One day he kills a lion, and then he comes back later on and the lion has a beehive growing inside of it. This is where he's collected the honey to give to his father and mother, but he has not told them where the honey came from. Samson has a weakness, and the weakness is named women. And he finds a woman that he wants to marry. He goes to his mother and father, and he tells them about her, and they agree to a wedding. Manoah goes to the woman, and Samson prepares the feast, and the family brings 30 men to the celebration, and Samson offers a riddle for them to try to solve during the 7 days of the feast, and they accept the challenge. The riddle is this: out of the eater came something to eat, and out of the strong came something sweet. The reward for the man who answers this riddle will be 30 changes of clothing and 30 linen wraps. For 3 days, the men struggle with the riddle, and finally they ask Samson's wife for the answer, threatening to burn her and her family with fire. She presses Samson hard until he finally tells her the answer on the 7th day. Back at the celebration, the men say, "What is sweeter than honey, and what is stronger than a lion?" Samson knows that they have conspired with his wife-to-be. Samson is so angry that he goes to Ashkelon, a Philistine town, and kills 30 men, giving their clothing to the festival guests. Returning to his father's house, he finds out that his wife has been given to his best man to be his wife. So during the wheat harvest, Samson takes a goat and returns to his wife, but her father will not let him have her because she belongs to his best man now. So the father offers her younger sister, but Samson does not want her. She will not satisfy Samson. Samson goes to the fields and catches 30 foxes. He ties their tails together and he sets them on fire. He releases them in the fields, and it burns all the wheats and the vineyards and the groves. And when the Philistines discover it is Samson's doing, they go to the bride and burn her and her father's family. Samson takes revenge, kills many of the Philistines, and retires back to the land of Judah. Now the Philistines regroup, and they pursue him down into Judah. And the Israelites ask them why they have come, and they tell him to bind Samson. 3,000 men of Judah go to Samson, pleading with him because they are under Philistine rule. Samson makes a deal to let them bind him if they will not kill him. They tie him up with 2 new ropes and take him to the Philistines. At Lehi, the Spirit of the Lord comes upon him, and the ropes fall off of him, and he finds the jawbone of a donkey and kills 1,000 Philistines. He is thirsty after the fight. God splits the hollow of Lehi, and water comes out to satisfy Samson's thirst. For 20 years, Samson judges Israel during the oppression of the Philistines. Now, Samson goes down to Gaza, and he sees a prostitute there that he likes. He goes to her, and the word is told to the Philistine leaders. They surround the city to kill him in the morning light, but at midnight, Samson leaves the city, taking with him the gates and the post and the bars of Gaza's entry. He carries them to the mountain opposite Hebron. Next, he falls in love with a Philistine named Delilah. The lords of the Philistines ask her to help find the secret to his strength, and Her reward will be 1,100 pieces of silver for each of her family members. Can you be bound? She asked Samson. Yes, with 7 fresh cords that have not been dried, I can be bound. And so she ties him up, and when she says, "The Philistines are coming," he quickly breaks them. "You have lied to me. Please tell me how you can be bound, Samson." "With new ropes," he replies. So she ties him up again, and when she says, "The Philistines come," he breaks them easily as before. "You continue to deceive me," Samson, Delilah says. So he tells her to weave his hair into a web. So Delilah does so, weaving his hair, and says, "The Philistines come," and Samson awakes and breaks the web. "You do not love me," she says, "because you have not been truthful." Day after day after day, she presses him for the secret. Finally, he tells her his strength is in his uncut hair. And while he is asleep, she calls for the barber who shaves the 7 locks of hair. The Philistines come, and he awakes, but his strength is gone. And the Philistines see Samson and puts his eyes out. And they make him a grinder at the mill in the prison. And during that time in prison, his hair grows back. One day, the Philistines have a celebration to their god Dagon, and they decide to bring Samson from the prison to show him off. And the people praise their god Dagon for giving them Samson. They allow a little Philistine boy to lead him into the temple, and Samson asks the boy to place his hands on the 2 major pillars of the temple. And the boy leads him to that place. The house is full. There are 3,000 more people on the roof looking in. Samson prays, and he begins to push on the 2 pillars. The people are amused until the house begins to fall. Samson dies that day in the great crash. All along with the people, he kills more in his death than he had during his life. His brothers and his entire father's household find him in the rubble, and they bury him in the tomb of Manoah between the town of Zorah and Eshtaol. The tribe of Dan still has not conquered all of the portion of land that belongs to it. They send an envoy of men from their family who are living in Ephraim to spy out the area to the north. And as the envoy comes to Micah's house, they recognize the young Levite priest and question why he is there. He tells them he has been hired by Micah to be his priest. He tells them to go on their way to search out the land. And from Micah's house, the men travel to the town of Laish, where they find the city living in peace and security. They return to the house of Zorah and convince them that they need to take the city of Laish as well as the surrounding land. The Danites continue to Laish, overtaking it easily, and there they set up idols and make this young Levite their priest. As long as the house of God is at Shiloh, the idol worship continues in Laish. So the Danites change the name of the city to Dan, and they finally possess their portion of the promised land. At the time the Danites are conquering their land, a Levite from Ephraim takes his concubine and journeys to her father's house in Bethlehem, where they stay for 4 months. The Levite is ready to leave, but the father is not ready for them to leave. He detains them 3 days, and then 4, and finally a 5th day by telling them to sustain themselves with bread. Now the father begs them to stay 1 more night, but the Levite is not willing. He takes his concubine and heads north to Jebus, a Canaanite city now called Jerusalem. Near Jebus, with his servant concubine and 2 saddled donkeys, the servant asks the Levite to stay in the city. But he will not, because they are not Israelites. However, the Levite is not afraid of the city, and they go through it and on to Gibeah. Now near Gibeah, at sunset, they enter the city for the night. They settle in the open square, and an old man coming in from the field invites them to stay with him, where he has food for all, and including their donkeys. Now while they are eating in the old man's house, several worthless men beat on the door, wanting the Levite to come out to have sexual relationships with him. He pleads with them and offers his virgin daughter, allowing them to do as they please with her. They do not want the virgin daughter. They seize the concubine and they rape her repeatedly all night long. When the Levite opens the door in the morning, he finds her dead with her hands on the threshold. He takes her dead body into the house, cuts it into 12 pieces, and sends a piece to each tribe of Israel with a message that says, "Consider it, take counsel, and speak up." The 11 tribes are appalled when they receive their piece of the concubine. They join as one force in Mizpah and ask, "How did this wickedness take place?" The Levite answers their question, and the Israelites organize 400,000 soldiers to march against the brother tribe of Benjamin, because Gibeah is one of their cities. The warriors march to Gibeah and demand that they deliver the wicked men back to them. But Benjamin refuses and assembles 26,000 swordsmen besides all the men of Gibeah. Within this group, 700 are left-handed and 700 can sling a stone at a hare and not miss. The 400,000 soldiers assemble at Bethel and ask the Lord who should go against Benjamin first. The Lord sends Judah. That day, Judah fights Benjamin, and 22,000 of the Judah tribe are killed. Israel is devastated by Benjamin's strength. On the second day, they attack Benjamin. Again, they lose with the death of 18,000 men. They return to Bethel, weeping before the Lord all night, not even taking time to eat food. That night, they present a burnt offering and a peace offering. The Lord hears their cry and tells them to fight again on the third day, and they will win. On the third day, Israel approaches as before, and Gibeah comes and kills about 30 men. This time, Israel retreats and Gibeah follows, drawing them away from their city. 10,000 choice men sweep in from behind Gibeah, and they kill 25,100 Benjamites that day. They rush to the city and take it by the sword. Another 18,000 are killed. The rest flee, but 5,000 are caught in Rimmon and 2,000 in Gidom. Then they are all killed. Another 25,000 Benjamites are also killed, but 600 get away and hide in the wilderness for 4 months. Israel kills Benjamin's cattle and burns their cities. Since the battle with Benjamin, a problem has developed. There are no daughters of Israel to become the wives of the sons of Benjamin. This problem stems from the vow that the tribes made at Mizpah that they would not allow their daughters to ever marry the sons of Benjamin because of their sin. So all the tribes gather at Bethel to seek a solution. They present offerings to the Lord and cry out to Him because one tribe is alienated from the whole tribes of Israel. A census is taken to make sure that all of Israel is involved, and they find the inhabitants of Jabesh-Gilead do not participate in the battle or send representatives to Bethel. 12,000 men are sent to Jabesh-Gilead to destroy the city for not participating in the battle. They are to kill every man and woman who is married, but they are to bring the virgin girls to Bethel to be given as wives to Benjamin. Jabesh-Gilead is destroyed, and 400 virgin girls are brought back. The 400 virgin girls are not enough. Benjamin has more young men who need wives, so Israel still will not break her oath and give daughters from their tribes. Just north of Bethel, in the city of Shiloh, the non-Jewish inhabitants have a festival every year at barley harvest, where the young virgin girls dance outside the city in the fields. So Israel tells Benjamin to go there and catch wives when they come out to dance. The sons of Benjamin do as directed, and they all get wives. When the leaders of Shiloh come to complain, Israel tells them that they are lucky they were not attacked in battle, and they will not give the girls back to them. With the battle with Benjamin over, all of Israel returns to the land of their inheritance. A king has not been chosen yet, so everyone does what he sees as right in his own eyes.